The cracking of the genetic code was a team effort, but Nirenberg and Matthaei's 1961 paper, The Dependence of Cell-Free Protein Synthesis in E. coli upon Naturally Occurring or Synthetic Polyribonucleotides, was the first step in cracking the genetic code. The central dogma, as described by Francis Crick in 1957, set the scene for Nirenberg and Matthaei's work. The central dogma is that information is transferred from DNA to RNA to protein unidirectionally. No information is passed the other way. Francis Crick had also proposed a sequence hypothesis, that the sequence of DNA bases determine the sequence of amino acids in a protein, based on a four-letter genetic code, G, C, A, and T, and 20 amino acids. He proposed that the code would be read in triplets, where each triplet coded for one amino acid. However, there was no conclusive experimental evidence supporting that DNA was read in triplets, and there was no idea which triplet coded for which amino acid. Experiments had been conducted using bacteriophages, viruses that infect bacteria, infecting Escherichia coli, that had shown that messenger RNA was produced from DNA and resulted in the synthesis of proteins. This showed that information was transferred from DNA to messenger RNA to protein, but how the RNA coded for the amino acid sequence in proteins was unknown. This is where Nirenberg and Matthaei come in, as they designed a system for and performed an experiment that started to figure out what bases in messenger RNA code for which amino acids. Nirenberg and Matthaei created a cell-free system that could synthesize proteins so that the interaction between RNA and amino acids could be easily manipulated. They purified ribosomes, ribosomal RNA, and transfer RNA from E. coli cells and used this material along with ATP as an energy source, as well as some salts and buffers required to keep the system stable. At the time, they called transfer RNA soluble RNA and did not know why it was important, just that it was vital for protein synthesis. To test the system could synthesize proteins, amino acids were also added, including carbon-14 valine, as it is radioactive, so its incorporation into protein could be trapped. Nirenberg and Matthaei showed that their cell-free system did result in protein synthesis, with the amount of carbon-14 valine incorporated into protein increasing as the concentration of ribosomal RNA increased. Adding RNAs to the system did not result in protein synthesis, and using DNA instead of RNA also did not result in protein synthesis. To test whether the protein synthesis was determined by ribosomal RNA or transfer RNA, the concentration of transfer RNA was increased, and this did not stimulate greater protein synthesis. These results showed that the ribosomal RNA was the determining factor of protein synthesis, although transfer RNA was required. After finding that RNA did determine protein synthesis, they then went on to conduct experiments using the same system to investigate the relationship between amino acid sequence of the RNA and protein synthesis. They had 20 separate experiments, one for each carbon-14 amino acid. They then added a synthetic polyU RNA, a strand of RNA only containing uracil bases, to each tube, where the phenylalanine tube was the only one where a protein was synthesized. This was the first time that genetic code had been understood. A polyU RNA results in a polyphenylalanine protein. In the conclusion of their paper, Nirenberg and Matthaei wrote, "The function of ribosomal RNA remains an enigma, although at least part of the total RNA is thought to serve as templates for protein synthesis. As a result of their paper, the function of ribosomal RNA did not remain an enigma for long, as they were able to adjust their experimental design to find evidence that genetic code was read in triplets, like Crick had previously proposed, and determine the RNA codon for a total of 15 amino acids that led to the completion of the codon table by other scientists. As a result of this work, now the sequence of amino acids in a protein can be determined by the DNA or RNA sequences. This has implications across all fields of biology, as proteins are the things that actually do stuff in organisms. Understanding the genetic code not only allows us to determine what the amino acid sequence of a protein will be based on the DNA sequence, we can also now make DNA sequences to produce proteins of our liking. We can make fusion proteins that fluoresce, understand why some DNA mutations change the protein structure and others don't, as well as understanding and treating the causes of genetic diseases. The genetic code has been cracked.